there'll be no data to support what I'm going to say, but in my limited view, the nutrition status has actually improved a little bit. Well, you can infer this from the fact that, the pandemic has mandated people to stay indoors, and likewise for nutrition, this has become an area of focus and emphasis. More and more people are eating at home. More and more people prefer eating home-cooked meals. They've been cutting down on junk food, as well as people have been embracing healthier lifestyle choices, exercise, yoga, breathing exercise, stress relieving exercise, etc., etc. Likewise, the nutrition intake of children has been a big focus as well, because it's become a major measure to fight the pandemic. The unavailability of the midday meal scheme has made families substitute this with healthier home-cooked meals. Recipe booklets have assumed a newfound importance, with them becoming the reference point for coming up with a variety of dishes, even with limited number of ingredients. Immunity has taken center stage, and healthier lifestyle has not just become important, but it's now crucial to the very survival. And therefore, the focus has shifted from service delivery to awareness generation. Digital outreach has become the order of the day. Helplines and telecalling services are being availed of more than ever now. At Nayara, we see that our nutrition and mental health lines that we set up have become very, very popular in the communities that we operate. Dependency on any one exclusive service delivery medium or mechanism is sure to burn this whole thing out. Besides, it'll make it grossly inadequate. Thus, for me, I would say public-private infrastructures provide the best complementary elements to make a success of any programs, especially nutrition-related programs. We can effectively use both of their strengths and leverage this for best delivery. Public infrastructure, which we know is far better as far as quantum is concerned, accessibility for the people at grassroots is concerned, and so can be used to reach out to masses. Likewise, private infrastructure can be better for off-section of the community where there is much more precise and precision-based delivery that is required. A defined delivery mechanism will ensure that both are able to reach out to relevant population sections and services are utilized to the optimum level. Private providers can tie up with CHCs and PHCs to provide low-cost quality service in required areas. And services like that of 108 ambulance can additionally cater to the urban area, thereby providing them with low-cost quality services. With both of them having deeper outreach in different forms, the complementary nature of both can be utilized to benefit the population as a whole. Moving on to the systematic healthcare challenges that plague the nation at large, we can best sum it up as the limited natures of 5 A's: awareness, accessibility, adequate manpower, affordability, and accountability. Studies on awareness are many and diverse, but the lacuna in awareness appears to cut across the lifespan in our country. Moving on to a study in India in 2012 found that in rural areas, only 37% of the people were able to access healthcare facilities within a 5 kilometer distance. Just imagine. The ones who lived further from the town, their accessibility had much more issues. A 2011 study further estimated that India has roughly 20 health workers per 10,000 population, with allopathic doctors comprising 31% of the workforce. While private sector accounts for most of the health expenditure in the country, the state-run health sector is the only option for much of the rural and semi-urban areas of the country. According to rural health statistics, the government of India in 2015 was about 10.4% of the sanctioned posts of auxiliary nurse or midwives were actually vacant, which rose to 40.7% of the posts for male health workers. 27% of the doctor posts as PHCs were vacant, which is more than a quarter of the sanctioned posts. Similarly, almost 75% of the healthcare expenditure comes from pockets of households, and catastrophic health cost is an important cause of impoverishment and other related nutritional issues. Added to this is the problem of regulation in the private sector and consequent variation in quality and cost of the services. Lastly, in turbulent times that we live in, Stress, which is the client-provider axis, is most severely affected. While unreasonable expectation may be at the bottom of much of this stress, it is time for ethics in healthcare to come to the forefront. Building synergies and constructive partnerships across domains, whether they are private, public, and civil society, would definitely be helpful in addressing some of the challenges listed above. Mostly, it would lift some of the burden off from the healthcare machinery. And number two, it would clearly demarcate the arenas where each of the above party has a role to play and can play a role. This, in turn, would help multiple issues being addressed simultaneously while creating a very, very symbiotic relationship, providing communities with the much needed access to systems and services. Nayara Energy point of view, we are clearly committed to carve out long-term changes in health and nutrition in our communities and in the country. That's a hard, fast commitment that we make to ourselves. While the blow to economy is not really unfelt, but we are unwavering when it says to this same cause. Likewise, our board has been extremely accommodating in this very difficult time by allotting a budget over and above the existing one in order to cater to COVID-related relief. This has not only sped up the COVID relief process, but has also ensured that no CSR initiatives, especially to do with our nutrition-related journey, are hampered or shadowed because of any unforeseen expenditure of the pandemic, thereby ensuring unhindered implementation of our health and nutrition programs in districts and states as per our plan. In fact, on a more generic front, I believe that the companies have rather expanded their expenditure on CSR instead of cutting it down, in spite of any economic challenges that may or may not be felt by various companies. Almost all companies now are working on COVID relief as well as contributing financially substantially to it. Apart from CSR, the companies are also providing COVID-centric employee benefits in terms of additional insurance, advance payments, fundraising, supporting education, healthcare of the children, paying salary to families of deceased employees. Just a few examples, but there's so much more that all companies are doing. We've also seen a change in the work culture, with almost everybody embracing work from home. Times have been tough, but the measures taken for employees' welfare as well as CSR are significant. On our part, we have made some really credible and long-term support in investments into our communities led by COVID. We put up a 50-plus, 50-100-bed COVID center with full oxygen facilities, medicines and doctors in our district in a village called Jakhar. We put up ambulances, all of them fitted with oxygen. We've tied up with UNICEF to implement large oxygen plants in our district and many more. So I would say, with the impact of economy being felt or not felt by various different companies, CSR and COVID-related measures have actually seen a kind of an increase rather than any kind of stop or stall. Like I said, health and nutrition are very, very long-term commitments that Nayara Energy has been working on. But actually way, way back before even the pandemic started. Programs like Community Health and Tushti since the last 3 years have been instrumental in addressing and putting in place some very, very stringent and strong mechanisms of preventive and curative healthcare in place. Besides, we managed to connect rural communities to round the healthcare services and bridging the access gaps. Similarly, we've had nutrition toolkits provided to TB patients in our district, thereby supplementing the efforts of the district tuberculosis department in fighting the prevalence as well as stigma associated with the disease. Recently, we have set up a COVID care center, as I mentioned, in one of our villages, providing 24/7 healthcare facilities to all patients who come in with mild symptoms of COVID. We clearly understand that healthy communities are the backbone of any society, and that focusing on robust healthcare systems and facilities would directly as well as indirectly impact the social and economic fabric positively. You know, I always like to tell everyone that doing community related support work is a license for us to do business. And that's very important. We operate on the land that we have, which is nearly 2,500 hectares of land, has been acquired from 15 villages in and around our refinery. I strongly believe as villagers and residents of this village, our primary duty is to take care of our family, which is this extended family of over 50,000 residents in this village. Our healthcare programs are similarly designed holistically with many components, each seamlessly feeding into the other to address all of these communities and beyond, right up to the city of Jamnagar, and take care of any issues that we have. When we talk of Tushti program, specifically, we counsel pregnant and lactating mothers on health and nutrition needs, because that's where it all starts. As a part of this initiative, but apart from that, we also have a nutrition telecounseling center where people can call up and free of cost get counseling services on health and nutrition. And this has seen an uptick now in COVID, with people coming and making much more calls, checking in much more about nutrition. All of this supplements the effort and completes the full cycle of health and nutrition delivery. Our ability to respond in unprecedented situation like this is actually what keeps us going. We feel a sense of responsibility towards our community and the nation. As a company, we realize that situations like these calls for us to rise, step up, and do more than what we would have done in normal scenarios. I'd ask the question, if not us, then who? At the end of the day, pandemics and other human-centric emergencies have human resources at the receiving end. And if they are impacted, then how do companies operate? So the first, and in the midst of the second wave, the dedication and commitment of the frontline workers, even at the cost of their own health, has been and will continue to be a massive source of inspiration for us here in Nayara Energy as we continue to deliver service. Equally inspiring is the government, which has stepped up to the scenario, ensuring that the nation continues to fight the battle against pandemic diligently without compromising on anything. As long as our country is battling with this pandemic so successfully and so well, Nayara Energy is clearly committed. Since we are fully committed to kind of ensuring that all our initiatives positively continue to deliver and clearly help the initiatives of the government of India.